Before I go to, I'm going to talk about a project, Ecosophic Urbanism. Well, it's more than a project, it's a theory. It's my theory, so therefore it's still in the making and it's unverified and it hasn't yet got public acclaim. So you're getting it in the raw. And on the left side of this page here, all these themes are my themes. And on the right hand side are themes which are particularly useful to me in developing my themes. So I'm going to talk about everything on that front page. So therefore, we may run out of time, but I'll do my best. And I want to end in a 10-minute film, so hopefully somebody nudges me at 40 minutes, so I'll just run a quick conclusion at that point so we can see that film. So, ecosophic urbanism, two words, ecosophic and urbanism, just to let you know what ecosophic means. Ecosophic, ecosophic, that's the wisdom of eco, eco being the base root of both ecology and economy, and sophy being wisdom. So the wisdom of ecology and economy, but eco going back to the Greek oikos, oikonomos, meaning dwelling. So really, we're talking about the wisdom of dwelling, and we're talking about urbanism as a wisdom of dwelling. So that's what that title refers to. the blue figures on the right are architectural theories, or theories on urbanism, and I'm going to go through them a little. Obviously, if I were to go through them and do them all justice, I would be here for a long time, so I'm just going to bring out some salient points. I'm going to talk about Patrick Geddes. Patrick Geddes, I hope you've heard of him, but Patrick Geddes came from Edinburgh, so my city. But he is incredibly influential, and especially to your Lewis Mumford, so historian and urban theorist. They were in correspondence for a number of years. So Patrick Geddes actually underpins an awful lot of theories of urbanism, but he's kind of relatively forgotten now, but because I'm from Edinburgh and he's with me every day, really, he's very present in our theorization of the city. And some of his theories actually are foundational to my point of departure. Andrea Branzi, so he is an architect in Italy, one of the Italian radicals of the 70s, and is still writing today, indeed, leading theorists. And Ungers. The Ungers theory. Really, I'm not going to go into that terribly deeply at all, but it's kind of it's interesting in its polycentricism, and I'll talk about that in a second. But the orange figures are people perhaps more readily known within philosophy, and I do want to talk about them too. But I'm going to skip through them a little because I want to talk about the middle one, Felix Mithali, the three ecologies. That's the kind of central thesis to this ecosophic dimension. And so I hope we'll have time to elaborate that through this talk. And what I've done to make it nice and succinct, I've produced a couple of mission statements, so I can cut through all that text, and I've got a number of points which I'll read out and elaborate as the key themes. But the three titles, The Loving Metropolitan Landscape, Architecture, Landscape, and Ecosophic Object, and Power Situation, these titles belong to each of those philosophers, and I can't talk about ecosophic urbanism without talking about these three themes. These three themes are interconnected for me. So I'll progress through this. So let's first talk about Agamben very briefly. So he operates somewhere between phenomenology, hermeneutics, post-structuralism, situationism, and critical theory. Kind of sits outside of mainstream thinking, but it's very popular today in contemporary theory. And he's responsible for at least two themes in this ecosophic urbanism. So one is the reconstruction of metropolis, and the other term is apparatus. So he takes us back to the ancient Greek term metropolis, so Athens being the first metropolis, and of course the first mother city, so the mother city to all its colonies. And although this has become a difficult term because of its association with colonisation and therefore the post-colonial critique. What he's saying is, but there is a way of understanding that if we remember this metro being back, coming back to the origins of mothers, so he's talking about care. So the idea that we're dealing with care, we're dealing with metropolis. So, and of course we understand today metropolitan landscape is really being the landscape of governance. And so what we're thinking of then through that title is a critique of governance and a care of governance. And so to affirm that particular idea, I put this loving in front of metropolitan. And I'm also invoking Ali and you on that. So loving is his. He's another contemporary philosopher who speaks of, he's one of the few people since Plato to theorize love. And in a nutshell, his love is risky love, non-risk averse love. So although we're caring about this metropolitan scale of things, we're not risk averse. We're going to be pretty risky in our theorizations. So the term apparatus then, succinctly, we're talking about the apparatus of community, the apparatus of government, and the apparatus of individuality. And Agamben uses the term dispositif, which is lifted from Foucault, and it's a critique of Foucault, really. But another way of thinking dispositif, as well as apparatus and the mechanics of things, is situation. So disposition, the situation of things. So when we think of situation, we're thinking of apparatus, or all that apparatus might be. And so we think that as community, government, and individuality, we're looking at therefore the relations between processes and individuals and communities, the infrastructures of institutions, therefore looking at the relations between communities, individuals, and institutions, and then the apparatus of individuality. We're looking at how individuality is formed by the relation of these other two apparatuses. So that's kind of critical, and that runs through everything. The ecosophic part, as I said, I'm going to go into this in a bit more detail, but Felix Guattari is post-Lacan and ran the Labor Clinic in France, and he worked alongside Gilles Deleuze, and two of their main themes that are important are anti-Oedipus and schizoanalysis, and quick way to understand it is to say, if I paraphrase, Deleuze and Guattari, they say they'd rather go for a walk with a schizoid than subject themselves to the Freudian divan. So it's essentially a critique of Freudianism and the Freudian apparatus and how the mind works. And they're promoting rather the sense of self as an interior, individual, self-centered, egocentric being. They think self is much more bifurcated, split, multiple, and engaged with lots of people all at the same time. And our individuality is defined by that. So, the term parasituation then, I take this from Michel Serre and his book, The Parasite. And it's useful to keep in mind three definitions of the para that is important, of course, as we understand parasite in its conventional sense. So we can take that para meaning as a feeding off, includes the symbiotic model, but radicalizes this as an inference towards a community of parasites and a chain of parasitism. And the basic premise of that is that we are all parasites, we are parasites. People don't like to necessarily hear that because they perceive that to be a pejorative term. But if you look at the science of parasites, you will find that parasites as organisms, single organisms, have been studied quite in detail. But science admits its naivety, its ignorance yet of the community of parasitism, so how parasites work as a chain. And so my work is taking that on by considering us as parasites. The second definition of parallel is this sitting alongside, which is quite an important aspect because this, when we take the term paradigm, paradena, this means one concept sitting alongside another. So the paradigm isn't the ideal, it's the thing that sits alongside the ideal. And so what we're there for, we can take with that is the this idea of multiple versions of things sitting beside each other. So things sit alongside each other. That's a really important aspect. And then para as an inversion. So Serre gives a critique of Marx. And Marx, he says, well, he's too fixated on this notion of use value and everything being necessary. And the problem with capitalism is that it's going to exchange value rather than use value. And because of this, what we have is this kind of build-up of false necessity. So anyway, so the long short of that is that Michel Serre says, but what about we move away from use value, and we talk of abuse value, and so there's a movement from the necessary to the unnecessary, or really, in truth, the as yet not known to be necessary. Okay, so that's a very quick and brief overview of the philosophical foundations or paradigms, if you like, that sit along my architectural practice, my architectural studio of theory. And now we move into some notions of urbanism. So this on the right is, in my view, quite a beautiful diagram that describes Patrick Geddes' theory of the city. And to give you a quick interpretation of it, so you see the Buddhist swastika in the middle, which provides a rotational movement to the diagram. And we begin on the top left, and it becomes repeated. You go round and round, going back clockwise from the top left. And it's an evolutionary diagram. And the top left and bottom left boxes refer to the town, the dynamics of the town. And the top right and bottom refer to the dynamics of the city. And essentially what it's kind of saying is that it describes a sort of movement from the size of a town, the kind of thinking of a town, the genesis of a town, and moving from town to city, how you get bigger to the city. But there's an important point in this diagram, which is a city becomes wrong at certain points in its history, and it needs to, as it were, deconstruct itself and go back to town and reconstruct itself again as city. So the top left, if we begin there, we say, we've got, before you have a town, you need a place, you need people, and they work. And all of these three things are necessary, and they create the acts of the town. And that's how the town works. They have agreed these constituent parts, and they provide for each other. And of course, once they realize that this is that what they're doing is quite helpful, quite useful to each other, they set up their school, which is the bottom left-hand corner. And in the schools, they learn how to work these three things of place, work, and people. And that goes on so long as it's a town. But there's this big shift that happens when we move into the city, where we need thoughts, theory, thinking outside of the box, thinking which starts to be speculative, thinking that starts to be something as yet not there. And he calls that the cloister. Geddes calls that the cloister, but we can understand that as university, we can understand that as the places where we study things which are not just the rudimentary necessary things of township subsistence. So if you like, this is the place of the unnecessary. So the university is not just the place of the necessary, this is the place of the unnecessary. And then of course that gets fed into deeds and the kind of things that get produced as a result of that. So you might talk about museums, institutions, the kind of achievements of the city. But as I said, we have to be careful because sometimes they go bad, they go wrong, and so therefore you have to think back to the acts in the first place between the place, the work, and the form. So that's a really important diagram, and this is a diagram of Biopolis, and the one strand that one ought to elaborate within this diagram is the relationship to the landscape. And that's the kind of the key aspect that Geddes provides. But rather than going into Geddes, we're going to do it through that process, that cyclical process, is called evolutionary urbanism. So enzymatic urbanism is a term, by the way, these terms, evolutionary urbanism and enzymatic urbanism, these are my terms. These are not terms used by the people themselves, the authors themselves. I use these terms to frame the key aspects of their motivation. Andrea Branzi. I'm trying to bring together two theories that he produced. One he produced in the 1970, and then the No Stop City, and one which he produced in 2010, Weak Metropolis. And to me, they're kind of two stages of the same theory. Let's see if I can get this in a nutshell. So that diagram on the right is essentially an old 1960s computer card with a few squiggles on it. And the way that we might begin to understand that is as a diagram of the city, where what Branzi is critical of is the rise of architecture being this commodification and commodified, and therefore, as it were, losing its place within the construction of society and just becoming a service to commerce. And so what he suggests then is that what architecture needs to become then, so in 1970 he posited the idea that architecture becomes even more commodified, as it were, hyper-commodified, very stylized, very call it avant-garde, progressive, in trying to transcend, as it were, that simulacra that was being exposed to. And therefore, a way of understanding that then is that architecture, that's just the looking wheel, anchors itself within this big network of repetitions and becomes unique and, as it were, holds and stops the metropolis from fading away completely as non-architecture. In the Weak Metropolis, he kind of takes this a lot further and he brings in the environmental aspect and he talks about these being environmental integration and he talks about microstructures. So he talks about these little anchors being as small as vases of flowers, people and personal computers, but imagining them spread out every 20 square meters. And he's responding here to ecological concerns, contemporary ecological concerns. And so the long and short of that is that he thinks the kind of lines we're working with, the old arrangements between city and landscape, the monuments, neighborhoods, streets, etc. These are the wrong paradise to be working with. And so he promotes this cohabitation of half agricultural and half urban territories. So microstructural, experientially attuned, hybrid and fluid territories. And he calls these enzymatic territories. And enzymatic territories are kind of things like, he's using a biological metaphor, not a chemical metaphor, biological metaphor, because he's kind of saying what you have to do is imagine an architecture that actually constitutes itself and allows things to grow around it and with it. And that enzymatic territoriality is different from, if you like, the limited territory of possession and ownership. It's very blurred at its edges, it's very difficult to discern its edges, and therefore, in conventional terms, quite paradoxical, because a territory, you might say, is defined more by limit than by, well, this is easier to understand it by limit, but what he's suggesting is it's defined by being within it. So that term is going to be quite crucial to us. And finally, the polycentric urbanism of Wimbrose Kruger's Call of Alaska and the Wagon. This is an urban paradigm that's put forward for Berlin. Berlin is a shrinking city. Now, you probably know the theories of shrinking cities, but essentially, there was a point in history where cities contained all this industry, etc., etc., and because of it going, the cities are shrinking, people are moving out, and a lot of the old Eastern Bloc cities are shrinking cities because all people are moving to the richer cities, etc., etc. So anyway, so there's this phenomenon where the cities are in area much bigger than the number of people occupying it, and maybe the key US example is Detroit, something like that. Ungers proposed back in 1977 was this idea that we use these islands of space that are forming, and we call them green islands, islands of agencies, and they can become our new enzymatic territories, and they set up polycentric networks of agencies. So those three things of the polycentric, the evolutionary, and the metropolis, the enzymatic urbanism, I take forward into my work, alongside those views of Agamben, Gortari, and Serre. So this is a little interlude. So although I'm not really going to talk about this, but I'm just putting this in here to let you know what I'm doing currently. So my studios are looking at Mumbai. I was invited to go and work in Mumbai. This is quite interesting for a number of reasons, but maybe the most obvious one is the project that we're going to have to show you is for a city of 80,000. And I'm now taking the same principles to a city of 20 million. And seeing whether they work in such a big scale. We're a year into this project, and we've got another year to run. These are some of the images that we're producing en route. And we're looking at, in here, the red is something of the mangroves, and the green is something of the conventional urbanism. And I say conventional, there's no such thing as conventional urbanism in Mumbai, by the way, but anyway, for the want of shorthand, I'll call it conventional urbanism. And the point in this is architecture and how architecture mediates between the urban and the red of the mangroves. And that's an interesting project in the making. This one is about rituals. So from the Ayurvedic yogic rituals of India to rituals of Hindu festivals, there are festivals every day, and there are so many territories that are determined, or if you like, more flowing, fluid territories and territoriality that we can understand by doing that, but there's no drawing of such a thing until this one. And it includes even the flight paths of the flamingos who have returned to Mumbai and mangroves and will soon die because they've been attracted to the growth of algae, but the algae is contaminated with mercury, so the flamingos have returned en masse but will die imminently. So this is a project that's trying to get a reconciliation of all those issues. A final example of this Mumbai project, this is one where 70% of Mumbai's population live in slums. They quite often romanticised as informal architecture. We're not romanticising them at all, we're taking them on and trying to deal with them in a slightly different way. But the principle we're operating from here is that at the moment there's a big kind of land grabs. So the slums are in the centre, the government are building these mass housing blocks on the outskirts and forcing all the slum dwellers to live there. Some slum dwellers don't like it because effectively they just don't provide what slums do provide, which is community, which are infrastructures attached to the rest of the city, and they become isolated. And although they might have running water and bathrooms, that isn't the principal concern of the people who live in these places. So this is a project that's trying to take that on and counter that land grab or money grab and all that corruption of these big housing schemes. So we've got, I'm going to show you these examples. And this is the city of Olbia in the northeast of Sardinia. Olbia is, Sardinia is an island off the west coast of Italy. I'm not sure you know, but its economy is principally tourism now. And Olbia in the northeast is the only city that's making money at the moment. Every other city in Sardinia is on an economic decline, and it's essentially why Olbia is on it doing okay is because it links to the Costa Smeralda up in the northeast, which is essentially a landscape of La Dolce Vita, green waters, beautiful. The area is granite, and together with the sea, what that does is make the water incredibly green. And of course, Russian oligarchs and the old Italian money people, some might say mafia, have bottled that up. It's well known for selling a scoop of ice cream for 50 euros. So that's the kind of nature of the economy. So it does mean, for example, things like indigenous economies like cork and granite are suffering a little because people are building second homes and letting them out for the month of August. So although it's a city of 80,000, 2 million people go through Olbia in the month of August. And lots of things happen as a result of that. So we were asked to look at this. This is when I was doing my my role as the visiting professor in the School of Architecture in Alghero at the University of Sassari. And we were asked to look at this and bring our methods to this. And so what we produced was a counter project, or if you like, a parasituational project, a project that sits alongside the local plan. So the local plan that you see on the right is very typical of a kind of local plan that you see anywhere in any city in the world. We'll have one of Edinburgh just like this, and it does the exact same thing, which is it zones things. It zones things. So if you see, for example, the big pink area in the top right, so that's a zone, that's the industrial zone. Historically, the industry and the people were all mixed in, but now what they do is they say, put it all out there, and anywhere we don't get things working, you stick a bit of green in, and hopefully that works. And you see the big green bit at the bottom right, that's the airport, and you see the pier in the middle. Now that pier is 2 kilometers long, and so between the pier and the airport, this is the means, and the big ring road, that's the means for getting these 2 million people into Olbia and out to the rest of the island. And they dominate the landscape. So, the conceit of our project was to do all these different parasituational projects that all sit alongside each other, and we bound them up in a couple of volumes, and that's the colour of the group. And so all those different colours at the top, if you like, the orange is the city of Olbia, and all those different colours are our projects, and the idea is that we sit alongside both the city and ourselves. I'm going to take you through some of these to show you how some of these work. So every colour we think of as an agency, but also a type of work, a type of output. So we have, for example, boat works. So these are the agency of the boats, or how the boats work. Cork and granite, the agency of cork and granite, and how the cork and granite works. Medicine, water, bees. We rephrase monument as biographies. Interesting thing about these, one of the interesting things with Sardinia is that it kind of avoided the Industrial Revolution, so it didn't have any major industry in its town and city. It did have industry, but they were tend to be outside. So it means that the contemporary urban environment is still owned by all the original families, so all the different families. So the family ownership is a really important aspect of how the city works, and it affects how the planning system works. So one might say, I mean, people do talk about the Sardinian mafia, because there are big families and little families, but the truth is that the families generally work reasonably well together, but we have this big Sardinian governmental apparatus that sits over, and even bigger than that, the Italian, and even bigger than that, the European. And the representative of Westminster could determine by negotiation what happens down in Olbia and the landscape of Olbia. And we'll take a view on, for example, how the economy of Cork in Olbia is to be registered against the economy of Cork in Portugal, even though the two systems of growth and nurturing are fundamentally different. And so we have to what we are trying to do in all of these projects is navigate all those different scales. And we've got projects for every one of those agencies, architectural language for every one of those agencies, and that multiple language, that heterogeneous production is, if you like, emblematic of the kind of city, overall city production and image of city that is promoted by this notion of ecosophic urbanism. So all the projects work together and are situated with knowledge of each other, but nothing is subservient to the other. They all work to equal right to have their say in this landscape. So I'm going to show you two examples. And after the first example, I'm going to do ecosophy and rapid fire ecosophy. So this is a project called Phenol Fragment Fictions, and it takes us as point of departure that pier. And the pier, as I said, is 2 kilometres long, and the reason it's the size and shape it is because what it has to do is reach the deep water to enable the ships, the cruise ships of 3,000 people each, to come in and dock. So actually the territory that it contains is bigger than it actually needs, because it only uses something like the edges. The inner is just this big empty field of tarmac, and it's useless. So what this does is it implements a fiction of basically deconstructing it, reconstructing it, and so the phyllo refers to layers, and the fragments refers to that magnitude of pieces. So keeping pieces that are necessary for the tourists coming in, but alongside that, in those cracks and crevices of its own making, finding opportunity, and of course imaging themselves as they go, and that attempt to image a deconstructed landscape. I was saying deconstructed, I'm deliberately kind of referring to deconstructed as architecture, but I'm trying to make a big difference here. They were not deconstructivists at all. This is merely a fictive apparatus that allows these, call it architectures, to be inhabited. I mean, a way of thinking of that drawing would be perhaps to think of it just very like Teatro Marcellus in Rome, you know, originally built as a theatre. Kind of policy in the medieval period after it was sacked by the various invasions. The medieval period, they came along and reappropriated as housing, and the Renaissance folk came along and upgraded those small medieval apartments into bigger palazzos. It fell into a bit of ruination again in the 19th century, but the 20th century now become really shishi apartments with jewelry shops, etc., etc. So that one idiom of the teatro has been reappropriated many, many, many times. So a way of thinking about that teatro Marcellus is to think of it as an inhabitation of a room. The way to think of this drawing is to think about it as a room in which the students can subsequently inhabit the program and other possibilities. So if you like, a room of one's own imagination. So these drawings become testing grounds for new briefs, new programs, and new opportunities. And of course, as time progresses, a different series of agencies and works start to make sense. And so this project is essentially creates a necklace of boat works and boat operations that exist in this newly creviced, cracked feel of a landscape. Aggregate and assemble as a series of fragments that hold themselves together as both autonomous pieces, but as pieces that work together within a network which serve the communities and house the communities, create new opportunities for the community. For example, in this particular fragment, which has been quite well resolved architecturally, it situates itself in the industrial zone in that scrapyard of boats, and constructs itself from understanding itself as the first piece of scrap to be reconstituted, and makes program which both makes boats, repairs boats, but also sets up a new boating club for the community. There is already an existing one, but it doesn't have such a formal apparatus. And so this celebrates that possibility of reconstructing the waste produced by this touristic economy. Okay, so that's one project. Right, so quickly then to rehearse and re-theorise, if you like, what ecological and ecosophical or ecosophic praxis is. So we say, okay, one, we make new microsocial and micro-political practices. So when you read Guattari, he says these things, but it's not always clear what he means. I hope by showing you this, some examples of architecture, you know, might be able to understand that. New solidarities, new relationships between people in the community. A new gentleness, so this gentleness is coming from both the statement that says, we will take care of this, the local scale, the metropolitan scale, we will put forward these projects, but we don't really insist. We just say that they're as prompts. Perhaps you could do it this way, it's up to you. By the way, this book sits in the mayor's office in Albia, it's delivered these books. It's part of the project. We had a meeting with him, and he seemed to quite like it, but then he'll like it more if he uses it and gets voted back in. So I'm not sure if he will, but anyway. So we've got new aesthetic and new analytic practices, especially regarding the formation of the unconscious. Now, that's a reference back to the fact that Guattari is a psychoanalyst, and what we're doing here is elaborating practices which affect our sense of being, and therefore our sense of how we store our information, and if you like, store it within the unconscious and reflect unconsciously. And we get engaged in processes of heterogenesis, many projects, and we instigate ways, many ways, heterologies, and those heterologies should be found to enable the singular, the exceptional, and the rare, and therefore what we call eco art, eco architecture, eco planning, in the sense of existential architectural planning, coexists with a state. So we're not saying we deny the state, we coexist with it, but we like that to be as least burdensome as possible. So the state's job is not to get in the way of eco practices, but in fact to facilitate it. So this is a contestation of how the state works. And we don't get involved in resolution of opposites. This is not oppositional architecture, oppositional thinking. This is, as I will reiterate, parasituational, sitting alongside, unnecessary, and feeding off each other. Sometimes there's consensus, but also sometimes there's individual and collective splintering, and that's perfectly all right. And there's tolerance, in fact, encouraging of event incidents. We decenter the social struggles, and we suggest that the exception can deflect or recreate the rule. So we don't have to persecute exceptionality, we can actually use it to help us make our rules more gentle. And we say that ecology is not the domain of a nature-loving minority of qualified specialists. So we're anti this idea that sustainability is appropriated by the technicians of sustainability, the engineers of sustainability, and we contest this whole principle that measures sustainability by points, where literally you can get more points for putting down artificial grass because it's made of recycled material than actually cultivating the landscape. So we can test that. So ecology questions subjectivity and capitalistic performations. And the principle is that each existential territory is precarious, finite, finitized, singular, singularized, capable of bifurcating into stratifying, and even deathbed repetitions. And that's harkening back to that Gedesian model of evolution. We have to remember that what we're doing is constantly dynamic, and we can't imagine that anything is fixed forever. We have to accept that things change. Okay, so I'll move on to that second mission statement. Some of these are repetitive, but they give another way of saying the same thing, you know. So the mission is to resist the normalization and making generic of otherwise specific practices and specific existential territories. And our means is by understanding the interrelation between the three ecologies. So again, just to reiterate, the environment, social relations, and human subjectivity. And the interest to give opportunity to the ecosophic object. Now the ecosophic object, I should just say, is a conceit, it's a paradox, because there is no such thing as an ecosophic object. What there is ecosophy, and what we previously called object as thing, if you like, is given the role of taking on the mission of delivering ecosophic wisdom. So the ecosophic object is this term that Gotali uses to infer such a thing. This happens quite a lot in philosophy, where people use the term to say exactly the opposite of what you think it means. So the concern then is that IWC, integrated world capitalism, seems to be about making more time, and we say for what? Because we don't really need all this time to go into it. We really want to spend the time making things properly. And we worry that global markets destroy specific value systems. We're not anti-capitalism at all. We just feel that we have to understand how the systems work, the apparatus, and all the scales of apparatus. You see on the right-hand side this TLML set B, L, G, and B. These are the four scales that we encourage ourselves to work at. The Loving Metropolitan Landscape Scale, which is the metropolitan scale, which as I have inferred sometimes is international in scale. The SEP scale, which is the series of enzymatic territories, or a way of easily understanding that is a whole number of buildings in relation. And the building scale and the body scale. So these four scales we think of all at the same time and work them through all at the same time. So all of our drawings, we'll look at in that particular thesis the pickleweed, which is salonica or sapphire, which is a product in Albia that, well, in fact, it's not a product, it grows there, but they haven't harvested it, but they could if they wanted to. But it's understanding the biology and how that parasites off the salt marshes, and how we salt parasites off the salt marshes. Sapphire, etc. So we're operating at that scale as well as the international scale all the way through. And maybe then the concern is that what we develop if we take this smooth practice of economy is really just a vague sense of social belonging rather than acknowledging that the vagueness pretends to be community rather than actually working. As community, and the fact that community is, in fact, quite textured, quite rough. Community isn't smooth, and we want to, as it were, bring about that asperity, that roughness, that texture back to community practices and economic practices. And therefore, that one aspect of the three ecologies, human subjectivity, we try to promote this idea of a transversalist conception of subjectivity, i.e. subjectivity is defined by our collective apparatus as much as our individual apparatus, and that we must invest ourselves rather than feeding ego, feeding that transversalism. And therefore, the transversalist subjectivity operates between the existential territories, we could call that program or architectural times, if you like, terms if you like, and the incorporeal universes, we could call that the poetics of practice, if you like. And these existential territories, therefore, are sensible, finite, and idiosyncratic, measurable. They actually are the ordinary things of the city, but they are invested with these incorporeal universes. So therefore, the task of ecology to repeat ways, many ways heterology to be found to enable the singular, the exceptional, and the rare, what we call eco-art, eco-architecture, eco-planning, the sense of existential architecture or planning is to coexist with the least burdensome condition of state as possible. And so finally then, before I show you this last project and the film, there's this famous statement by Kurchutsky, and evoked by many people, including Gregory Bateson, his quality of mind, he says the map is not working. So that is a warning that says to those that produce, for example, urban plans, the zoning diagrams, that the map is not generally, be careful that we don't make our cities just like those zoning maps. But I would complicate that a little bit, and I would say that architecture is the bridge in a territory, and the architectural drawing is the territory. So actually, I might say the map is the territory, but only insofar as that drawing takes on this petrol condition and not this static condition of the master plan. So finally then, this final project, this is just one of the two projects I'm showing. I could have shown you 24 projects, 30 projects, but and together with that, you would build up a very clear image of what the city of Albion is like. This is a project that investigates. So this is, if you like, this is the map, is the territory. I would argue this is a drawing that tries to record the saltiness of the Albion Basin. The fresh water of the hydrological perimeter to the basin and the mineralogy of the basin. So I'm not even sure you would get a drawing of this in bioplanning or bioregional planning because this is highly interpretive. And what this project does is take a number of sites across that terrain. And at the point I think I'm going to jump into the first of two films, a little 2-minute film, and it kind of shows how it develops a power station, an osmosis mill. I don't know if you know that there is a technology whereby the meeting of salt and fresh water creates energy and it can be harnessed. There's a city in Norway at this moment, a city of 20,000 people, run by, as an experiment, run by a generator which works on the principle of osmosis. This project then gathers itself around that principle in the five estuaries, or five riverheads in Albion. So this is just one of the buildings. First building, the osmosis dome. So in the water, brackish water between the salt and the fresh water, there exists the lamprey, the Albion lamprey. I'm sure we have them in the US as well. But they operate on the basis that they can survive in both the salt and the fresh water. And they actually are parasites, if you like, but also they provide the model of this osmosis reverse filtration process. This is an architecture that takes that principle. It resolves one of the problems of Albion, which is that it's got a water shortage. 2 million people, especially in August, they come in, they demand water, use water. And August actually coincides with the driest month, so they have to develop systems. And they're in the process of developing systems for storing and distributing water, so this occupies a site at one of the canals. And by virtue of capturing the power from the osmosis mill, it develops itself as an as-you-write mill. So it also As you write, is the blue mineral that was used in the Renaissance for all the blue paint. As you write, it's plentiful in Sardinia, but it's stopped being mined because artificial blue, petrochemical blue, has replaced it. But it's an economy that could be reopened and could be even at the artisanal scale. So that project starts to become the basis of another kind of process where we take the local plan and we allow this leakage of the blue to this is this site, so that process, that's the site of the osmosis mill. Sits in one of the canals. And by conceit, a narrative conceit of saying all those people that come in blue come and go through the Azurite mill will have this kind of blue footprint and tread on the ground of Albion. And what the blue is used to do here is to invigorate the vague terrain. I don't know if you know Solomarana's notion of Sharan Valley, but essentially every city has this kind of leftover space, and it's generally created by zonal planning, because at the edges of one zone and another, you get this kind of no man's land. And one of the aspects of Solomarana's theory that's quite often forgotten is that you really don't understand this as vague terrain or the principle of vague terrain until you bring it into representation. In this project, it's done through photography, but in our project, it's done through urban design. And that blue becomes the means of investigating other sites. And there's a whole series of things all up and down the Obvious Basin. And some of these are developed in greater detail. And just to show that these are very well considered architectural projects, thoroughly well researched and thoroughly engineered and drawn up, and meet all professional requirements, but we go beyond that. And of course, we create the appropriate space in which that project should be shown. So this space here is just that one project exhibited at the conclusion. So now I'm going to go into this film, which takes 10 minutes to play through. I hope that we'll have time for that. And the conceit of it is that it's the day in the life of the kind of urban planner that operates to ecosophic urbanist principles. Thank you.
subjectivity. It strikes me then, you know, the intensity and sort of genius of the work is not coming from the individual students per se, but rather coming as part of the product of the process. And I guess I'm curious what role the drawings play and how you sort of facilitate that process.
That's a complicated question. Okay, so maybe one way of saying that is